Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Bob Irving, and I welcome you to Solbury United Methodist Church. Before we get into announcements, go Eagles.
Yes.
Does anyone have any announcements this morning?
Go Bengals.
Homer.
And Eagles.
Does anyone have any announcements this morning?
I just want to say that to thank the folks that have brought both dinners today and food to be packed. We have 103 dinners in the freezer. Got finished up those up this week, and so we have a nice little start on with the ham that Edna sent. We'll have a nice start for February, which is a short month, so we don't really have as much time. So that's a good thing. The other thing is, I did put out the information that Norma has passed this week, and her service is going to be at her home church in Westfield, New Jersey, on February 11th at 10 o'clock, and her daughter, Katie, did send me a message saying that they were also going to try to stream it, which they had done for Bill's service as well. So I will send out all that information as soon as I get it.
Thank you. I'm sorry to hear about Norma. For those of you that don't know Norma, Norma is a deacon in the United Methodist Church. She'll always be a deacon, even if she's with God. And she was great to have here. She ran Bible studies. She ran the book studies over for Advent and for Lent. And it made it easy for me to go away and see someone because Norma could come up and preach, and she was very good. Other announcements? Then let us center ourselves for worship. Will you please rise if you are able and join me in the call to worship? Come and hear the good news.
That our Lord is happy in our lives. God's blessing and love is with us.
Come and hear what God wants us to do. And get courage and strength from Christ.
We pray for courage and discernment from our Lord and Savior, that we may show ourselves to be followers of the way. Lead us, Lord. We pray in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Will you please join Marge and our new member, Connie, in our opening hymn, Softly and Tenderly, Jesus is Calling, found in your hymnal number 348.
Thank you.
in the opening prayer. Loving God, we come this morning seeking to abide in your presence. Open our minds to your spirit of wisdom, that we may know how to live as your people. Open our hearts to your spirit of truth, that we may love all your people with a love that speaks of justice, kindness, and radical grace. May this time of worship be authentic and pleasing to you. Amen. Please be seated. Our first reading this morning is from the prophet Micah, chapter 6, verses 1 through 8, and can be found in the insert in your bulletin. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the case of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a case against his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt, and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, what Balsam, son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require you but to do justice and love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? This is the word of the Lord. Jesus said to his disciples, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you."
This is day 29 of my cold. Which makes me think it's more allergies than cold. So I'll say, "Peace be with you" from up here, and you guys can offer one another a sign of peace. And also with you.
Thank you.
Now was the time for our sharing of joys and concerns. Does anyone have any joys that they wish to share?
I'm just appreciative of family at this time. It's just like I've spent some quality time with them, so it was very lovely. And I appreciate having them.
Other joys? I heard his grandmother is a rabble rouser. How about concerns?
I have one. Did you want to go before?
No, go ahead.
My son's coworker last Monday night at 31 years old had a massive heart attack and passed away. He was only 31 and left three young ones behind. So we've been kind of coping with that, and having my son was, you know, worked closely with him, and he would love this game today. His name was Hank, and he was always, as soon as you walked into the yard of the office, he'd be, "Go Birds!" So they're getting a jersey made with his number and putting it off. But it's just, I'm praying for Christina and his girlfriend and their three young ones. I don't know all their ages. I think my son said 3, 2, and I don't know the other one. So they're very young, and I just want to pray for Christina and her family to get through the days to come.
Lauren?
Oh, continue prayers for my neighbor Virginia, whose leg is not, doesn't seem to be healing quickly enough. It was a bad break.
Other concerns?
I have one. My friend and neighbor, Tony, was taken to Doylestown Hospital last night and a possible heart attack. He's in his 60s.
Wow.
I do have one also. Randy Brill. Larry is our sextant. His wife is having a procedure, she's having surgery on Friday around kidney issues and kidney stone issues. So prayers for her. She has had multiple physical problems.
I actually just remembered a joy, and that is that we've been praying for Kai, who was in the hospital, Sue Horak's grandson, and he is now home.
Oh.
Do we know how he's doing?
I assume okay.
I
have
to assume.
Yeah, I haven't heard otherwise.
My cousin Bev, who's only 73, is moving into a memory care facility tomorrow, and it's been very hard on the whole family. Her sister in particular.
Other concerns? Then let us pray. God, we thank you for the opportunity to spend quality time with family. We're thankful for responding to prayers and allowing young ones like Kai to come home. And we pray for Christina, who recently lost her boyfriend and has three young children. We pray that your loving hand will comfort them, and that the people around them will support them. We pray for Virginia, that she continues to heal and that she is made whole. We pray for Tony, who suffered a possible heart attack. We pray for the doctors and nurses that are treating him and are treating everyone with an illness or an injury, that they have the knowledge and the skill to make them whole, and that they have the empathy to treat the whole person and not just the problem. And we pray for Randy Brill, who who is going to be having surgery. We pray that the doctors and nurses again have the skill to bring her back to us whole. And we pray for Bev and for all families who have had a loved one move into memory care or skilled nursing or assisted living. We pray that the transition goes smoothly, that she adapts to her new environment, and that the family grows comfortable with the fact that she's getting good care. And we pray especially for the Hockenjoss family. Norma was a dear friend to us. We ask you to forgive her sins and accept her into your heavenly kingdom. And we pray for her daughters, that they feel your calming presence upon them. And now, as the congregation names the names of the people that are on their heart, we will respond with, "Lord, hear our prayer." Lord, hear our prayer.
Harry and Nancy.
Lord, hear our prayer. Hear these prayers, O Lord, and the prayers for the people that are on our heart that we did not mention. And we praise you and worship you by reciting the words that your Son taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Will you please join Connie and Marge in our next hymn, "Be Thou My Vision," found in your hymnal, number 451. Chapter 5, verses 1 through 12, and can be found in the insert in your bulletin. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountain. And after he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning again.
Good morning.
My name is Bob Irving, and it is a pleasure to serve as the pastor here at Solbury United Methodist Church. And I wanted to tell you a couple things before I got started. I took this test, and this test was supposed to identify your five greatest strengths. And one of my greatest strengths was lifelong learner. Because I always like to learn things. I read things. I never accept what somebody says that's meaningful just on face value. I always go and look into it. And I had a thought, which sparked me to do some research. It seems that organized religion, Methodists, Catholics, Presbyterians, Baptists, are suffering either a drop or just kind of a plateau in terms of membership. And it fluctuates. It's kind of like if you ever look at a heartbeat, you know, boink, 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 right? But there is a general trend, if you tie all the dots together, of it moving downward. For example, back in the early 1980s, 80% of the United States of America described themselves as Christian. The most recent one I saw, which is from the 2010s, was 60%. That's quite a drop. That's, you know, what, 20 million people, 30 million people? That's pretty significant. And it's funny because a lot of the things that are happening because of people's priorities. But there is one type of church that is growing. And it's growing very quickly. Now, that's kind of simple. If I start a church in my dining room, and there's nobody there, and then the next day, one person shows up, well, I've just had a 100% growth rate, right? But they are growing very quickly. And one of the things about the evangelical churches that are growing is that they preach strictly from the scripture. They don't follow a lectionary. Now, there are some phony ones out there. Don't get me wrong. And as Jesus said, beware of false prophets, for they are wolves in sheep's clothing, which is where that saying comes from. However, at the risk of being removed from this assignment, I have a secret to tell you. I do not think that the church as a whole is moving in the right direction in the United States of America. And this is not political. It has nothing to do with the church, big C rulings or findings or discipline. It has to do with all of us, practicing Christians. We just don't get it. Now you may say, get what, Bob? What on earth are you talking about? Well, I am glad that you asked. I do not say these things lightly. And actually, I feel like oftentimes when I think about these things and preach about these things, I should be looking into a mirror. Because that person in the mirror needs to hear these things as much as everybody else. This is something I have included in my prayers for weeks now. And it just hits me. There's a different kind of pandemic going on in the United States. It is a pandemic of fear, discouragement, gossip, and general malaise. It seems to affect the middle and upper middle class more than any other group of individuals. It is not monitored by the CDC or any government agency. And I also believe that I am a contributor, sort of a Typhoid Mary, of the pandemic, this particular pandemic. Now, I know that the last two sermons were a little rougher. They weren't as nice as what most of my sermons were. They didn't contain a lot of jokes. They were very serious. Less levity. More speaking about our roles and responsibilities. But I want you to take a minute and look around this church, even though we have a rather good crowd today. Do you think that this is how Jesus wants this church to look? Because I don't. Now, the recent pandemic, the aging of the congregation, it's taken a toll on this church. I was just talking to Marge earlier, saying how, okay, well, we have 14 people here today. And I know 4 people are watching at home. All right, so that's 18. When I started, we'd have about 25 to 30 every Sunday. We had 2 people move. We had 2 more people move. We had 3 people move. We had, I believe it was 6 deaths. We had somebody transfer to another church. So our numbers keep going down and down and down. And the recent pandemic and the aging of the congregation, I'm speaking not just in terms of monetary donations to the church, because let's face it, money keeps the church going. And I'm not just speaking about attendance at the church either, but I'd like to offer a little bit of clarity before I continue. When the pandemic, the coronavirus pandemic, first happened, people were staying home. We weren't allowed. I'll repeat that. We were not allowed to hold a church service. People were fearful, and the flame of that fear was fanned by just the general ignorance. And it wasn't just our general ignorance. It was the ignorance of the government, the ignorance of the media. And we're still kind of ignorant about the whole thing. And there was a lot of innuendo. Sort of like when the AIDS epidemic was around, and people were afraid to use public toilets because you could get AIDS from the public toilet. That was one of the rumors that went around. And that fear actually became greater than people's faith in God, and greater than their fear of God. And I have a lot more to say, but before I go on, please pray with me. Lord, as we struggle with the inadequacies of our mortal existence and our tendency to focus on earthly things, we ask for your guidance. We pray that you give us the strength to overcome our fears and to fulfill the mission and purpose you have set before us. We pray this in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen. And before I go on, let me talk about my contribution to this pandemic. I have up here a tendency to teach rather than preach. I tell you what the meanings are, for example, in the Beatitudes today, that one, the meek shall inherit the earth. The word they use as meek is not our understanding of the word meek. Meek actually means men. It means men because back then it was male-oriented. Men with swords that know how to use them, but keep them sheathed. It means dangerous people that choose peace. A teaching moment, not a preaching moment. I have very limited time for visitation because I have a full-time job And I have lots of stuff going on in my life, as you all know. And incidentally, my mom is doing well, thank you very much. And my mother-in-law is actually doing well as well. I have limited time for Bible study. How many people in here have ever gone to a Bob Bible study? Yeah. When was the last time Bob ran an Advent study? I'm not talking about when I do it on the PowerPoints here. I mean, before church, Advent study. How about a Lenten study? How about prayer meetings? You know, we get together on a Wednesday night, we pray for people, we all skid around in a circle, right? We've done that, what, 100, 200 times? Maybe not. And how about the dreaded committee meetings? Except for the worship committee meeting and the occasional staff parish relations committee meeting, which is more Connie, Mike, Michael, Carol, and myself just conversing about what needs to happen. We really don't have them. And part of that is my problem because I don't think that the whole worshiping Jesus and worshiping God focuses around committees. It just doesn't seem to make sense to me. It's never made sense to me. But I'm not up here saying mea culpa, mea maxima culpa. If you're Catholic, you understand what that means. And what about your contribution? You've made a contribution to this pandemic as well. We continue in the same way all the time. We are proponents of the seven deadly words. Do you know what the seven deadly words are? We never did it that way before. We do minor changes here and there, all of us, and it makes us feel good. We do the food, we do the garden, we do these other things, and those are all things that we should do. But we are comfortable in our Christianity. I seem to remember Jesus saying, pick up your cross, your burden, and follow me. I don't seem to remember him saying, sit in your cushy chair, listen to some bombastic guy spout out words, and follow me. So why the middle class and the upper middle class, which incidentally is this church? Well, think about the ministry of Jesus. Jesus was ministering to the poor, to the downtrodden, to the oppressed, to the imprisoned. They, the poor, they need a Savior. These city churches that we have cannot continue on their own financially. Part of our apportionment goes to city churches because those people don't have the financial resources to sustain their church. But if you go to a service down there, I guarantee you there's more than 14 people. There's a couple hundred. And they don't just sit there. It's very interesting to see the discomfort on a, and I this is going to sound a little racial, but on a bunch of white people in a black church, seeing people say, yeah, preach it, yeah. Right? You see, the middle and upper middle class people are trying to get by. Do you think gas prices really affect the wealthy? Do you think eggs going from $1.09 a dozen to $4? The last one I saw at Aldi of all places was $4.65 a dozen. Do you think that affects the wealthy? It affects the middle class and the upper middle class. We're just trying to make a world better for our children and grandchildren. That's all we're trying to do. And oftentimes, that means a lot of stuff gets in the way. So, what do we do? Is it possible that we, meaning all of us, me included, have become too complacent in our faith? Think about this. To know Jesus Christ, to grow as his people, and to lead others to embrace him. I've heard that somewhere before. See, what we need, I think, is we need an instruction book. Our faith is like a bookcase that's come from IKEA. We need the instructions to put it together. But we have an instruction book. In Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 through 20, as Jesus came, and Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." In Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 through 16, we're told, You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Paul, in his letter to the Corinthians, his first letter to the Corinthians. Be imitators of me, as I am of Christ. John, for I have given you an example that you also should do just as I have done to you. And one last one. Matthew chapter 7, verse 21. To counteract anybody that's a universalist that thinks that all people go to heaven. Not everyone who says to me, "Lord, Lord," will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. So, what does that mean for us? All that gobbledygook I just spewed at everyone. Well, that brings me to the title. I never knew that the Beatles wrote a religious song until I looked at the words of this song. This is a very religious song that people took as a love song. Help, I need somebody. Help, not just anybody. Help, you know I need someone. Help. When I was younger, so much younger than today, I never needed anybody's help in any way. But now those days are gone, and I'm not so self-assured. Now I found I've changed my mind and opened up the doors. Sounds a lot like this congregation. Most of you got through the raising of children. Most of you got through the jobs. Some of us are still working. Us poor, pathetic people. It seems like when it comes to discipleship, we need help in some areas. So, why come to church? Let's start there. Why do people come to church? Is it because I'm entertaining? No. Is it because I belong in GQ? No. And it's not for my glasses. Church is not for the righteous. Church is for the broken. Church is for the people who are struggling. Church is a place of renewal. It's for those people with difficulties. It's for a renewal of your faith. But it's also for instruction, to help us learn what we need to do to be better disciples. It's for renewal of our spirit. Because we are creatures of habit. When this service is over, after everyone's had their refreshments, I will go into my office the same way I've gone into my office since September 11th of 2020. Wow. 2021. I will change my clothes. I will pack up my car. I will go straight to Pickering Manor, and I will see my mom until such time as it's lunchtime. Then I will wheel her over to the table. Then I will leave and chit-chat with receptionists at the desk. And I chit-chat with them because I know I get special privileges because all the different receptionists at the desk like me because I stop and talk to them and listen to them. So I can come in during lunchtime where other people can't and still go see mom. Yes, I manipulated them. I admit it. And then I will go home. I will change my clothes. I will download my video to YouTube. I may or may not send it to Connie, depending on what else I have to do. Michelle is still in the Poconos. So I will run downstairs and see if anything needs to be cleaned up before she gets home to make sure that she doesn't get stressed out when she comes home. Then I will turn on the football game. And I will sit there and watch the football game. Michelle will come home. I'll see her pull in the driveway. I'll run out the garage door. I'll grab her bags. I'll take them upstairs for her. Then I'll come back to the football game. Creature of habit? Yes. And tomorrow morning, my alarm clock's set for 5:10 every day. I get up every day at 5:10. I go down to a chair that's in the living room with a cup of tea. I say my prayers because Carol and Connie sent me the prayer list. Then I watch the sunrise. Then I bring a cup of tea to my wife. See, I'm doing the same thing all the time. There's very little deviation unless something happens. Somebody broke down on the road, somebody's sick, somebody needs something from me. Very little deviation. We're creatures of habit. You know that thing that you can't teach an old dog new tricks? I am an old dog. But the key to discipleship means new tricks. It means more than going to church. I've said it before, and I'll say it again. Going to church and calling yourself a Christian is like standing in a garage and calling yourself a car. It's not the same thing. And it's not for everybody, because it's not easy. Because we are emotional people. I should go to my neighbors, my good friends, people I love, Tom and Pam, who are Catholic, and do not go to church, and say, hey, you guys know that Jesus loves you. Why is it that you don't go to church? Well, you know, Tom will say, well, you know, I was married before and got divorced. And then the church wouldn't let me marry Pam, so I had to get married at a justice of the peace. I said, that sounds like a church thing, not like a God thing. Maybe you ought to find a different church. God still wants you to come. He still wants you to show up. Do I do it? Laurie says yes. She's the only one that ventured a guess. Yes, I do it sometimes. But is it uncomfortable? Yes, it's very uncomfortable. Because we invite them over for dinner, they invite us over for dinner. One of these days, they may say, let's not invite them because Bob will come. He'll start talking about Jesus again. You see, the gospel of this morning, the Beatitudes, we've gone through that 100 times. Well, not 100. We've gone through it at least 7 times. And you've heard it before, not just from me. But it's not a prescription. It is a description. It's a description of who God watches over. You see, if you're struggling or have problems, and you're a person of faith, you are more likely to enter into heaven than if you have an easygoing life. Because more is asked of you if you have an easygoing life. You have less to contend with. Yes, I know. You know who has the biggest problem in this room? I do. You know why? They're my problems. That's why. And everybody else should feel the exact same way. But, of course, one of your problems is me. But the key thing here is we have to push past it to become better disciples. You see, God watches over those who cannot pick up their cross and follow him because they're already carrying a cross that's too heavy for them. But it's not too heavy for us. There is nothing too heavy for us. We are people of faith. We are the children of God. You know, the name Israel, I don't know if you ever knew this, but do you know what the name Israel translated means? Those who struggle with God. That's what we are. We may not be Jewish, but we are people that struggle with God because we struggle between what our mortal duties are and what our kingdom duties are. And you may or may not have the capacity for discipleship. And that capacity will change on a daily basis. Today, everything may be going right, so you have the capacity. Tomorrow, somebody may be sick that you're caring for, and you don't have the capacity. You don't have the time. But if you do have the capacity, you need to ask yourself one question. What is holding you back? And what can you do to overcome it? Amen. Now is the time for our offering. We do a non-contact method of offering. If anyone has a donation, a tithe, an offering to put in the plate, there's a plate on the back table. You may get up now, put it in the plate, and when everyone is done, Wayne will bring it forward, and then we will sing the doxology. Number 94. Thank you. in the offering prayer. God of all blessings, your beloved Son teaches all we need to know to proclaim the life you hope for us. In spite of that, we live like the rest of the world that is eager to accumulate and reluctant to give, showering adoration on the rich and powerful, and pushing the poor and powerless. And we bring to you our gifts, which are the result of your blessings. Help us to remember who Jesus called truly blessed. We pray in the name of our teacher and Savior. Amen. Please join Connie and Marge in our closing hymn, Trust and Obey, found in your hymnal, number 467. Please join with me. As we go forth, we pray that we will live lives pleasing unto you, O Lord. We strive to embrace kingdom values of truth, love, mercy, and grace. We ask for your blessing. In your name, Jesus Christ. Amen.